next step to undertake at this point is to turn off this global view. You may not want these maps showing now, and click on the California view. You can minimize the global view by clicking or the minus sign in that instance and click on the California view. To zoom to this, just click on the full extent button right there, and that will zoom us over to our area of interest. I'm going to turn off some of these layers to begin with, and what I want you to focus your attention on, at least at this moment, are these blue lines here that you see crisscrossing the Southern California map. If I turn off the reference layer, you can see these. These are fault lines, and there's a lot of them. There's one very large set of them across here that you should be particularly aware, and another fault that is active that is of a good bit of interest to you. But all of these faults are capable of producing really large earthquakes, even some of these small ones that seem somewhat insignificant are capable of creating deadly earthquakes. You can turn on and off some of the layers. Here's the major earthquake since 1970, and you can click on them to get a little bit of information about them and the faults that they're associated with. For example, this one here from 1991 over in this area. If I turn the reference layer back on, that's here in the foothills of the San Gabriel Mountains, just north of Sierra Madre out in the Inland Empire. So I encourage you to turn these layers on and off. You are asked to answer a few questions where you have to identify a fault. Here's one running just north of Fillmore. If I click on that fault, it says it's the San Cayetano fault, and that might be an answer to one of the questions that you get. So you may want to pause here, identify a few of the faults, and then come back to this video tutorial. Okay, I'm going to turn off the earthquakes layer, and I'm going to turn on something called the fault proximity risk layer. As you can see, this is this layer appearing in green on my map is nothing more than a buffer layer around each of the faults. So if I zoom in closely here around this large fault and I use the little measuring tool, I can sort of measure across and see that that's about 7 miles across. So people that live within this zone of this fault are at a greater risk of earthquake damage than if they live further away. That's just the way it works. There's a lot of energy released nearby and it dissipates over space. That's why if there's an earthquake on this fault, people in Las Vegas will hardly feel it, but the people who live close by will feel it a lot. Notice that the edges of this fault proximity risk layer are jagged. That's because each of these are pixels, and each of these pixels has a value, and the value in this instance is just a value of 2, which is to say that it's a unit of increased risk over if I click off the map and it's only 1. So we're saying that you're essentially at double the risk if you are within a close area. This type of map is different. This layer, it's a raster map. It's made of pixels, and it functions much like a JPEG or other type of image file, except that each of the pixels is assigned a value. So that's one of the risks, being very close to a fault. And then I will turn on a secondary risk map, the slip rate map. So it's a little larger. This was supposed to be something to the effect of a 5 miles on each side, so it should be around 10 miles across, depending on how you measure it. But so within a 10-mile radius of this fault, you have yet additional risk factor. And this fault slips at a specific rate. The more frequently faults slip, the more likely you are to find yourself in an earthquake, as opposed to some faults that don't slip much at all. And then there's a second slip rate map. I'll turn this first one off. You see that this layer, or this fault here, still has risk associated with the fault proximity, but this other slip rate map, another raster map, this is a fault that slips frequently, and so you are at a greater risk of earthquake damage because if you live here. The next map that has a type of risk associated with it is the liquefaction risk map. And this is, again, sort of a crude pixelized version of a liquefaction maps that started out somewhat differently, but these are 1,500 meter squares that indicate large or increased risk from liquefaction. Liquefaction is soils that have a extra amount of water in them and a composition that turns them into a kind of quicksand. I have placed a link to a YouTube video on liquefaction so you can bring yourself up to speed on that if you've never heard of it. So if your house or mall is on a area where the soils are prone to liquefaction, that increases your risk as well. And then the last of these maps that I'm going to turn on is the basin depth map. And this is essentially how deep the dirt or the soils underneath us are. In some areas, particularly up in the San Gabriel Mountains, where the dirt has all washed off the mountain because of gravity and slope, there is a lower earthquake damage risk from the ground up because there isn't much soil. Here in the San Fernando Valley, and particularly in the deepest parts of the Los Angeles Valley basin, the soils are quite deep, and that increases the shaking amplitude and violence in some instances. Now, this is not to say that if you're in the mountains and there's a landslide that happens because your house is on the side of a hill and there are big loose rocks above you, that you're somehow completely safe in the mountains during an earthquake. That's not the case. You're just at a different kind of risk. But we're only going to, in this lab, worry about the basin depth map. So if you turn on all of these layers, you begin to see that you have at least 5 different risk factors that you can account for. There are some areas that have many fewer risk factors than others. How do we account for all of these risk factors simultaneously so that we may understand something about the insurance risk associated with insuring each of these shopping malls against damage during an earthquake? Essentially, what we are going to do is to add up these risk factors with small multipliers to make it look like the professional risk assessment maps, which are done similarly to this, but with a great deal more mathematical precision. So in your learning management software, I have given you a formula here, and you can go ahead and copy that formula and open the ARC Toolbox. Click on the little red toolbox. From the ARC Toolbox drop-down menu, you should see Spatial Analyst Tools. If you don't see Spatial Analyst Tools, then go to Customize, Extensions, and make sure Spatial Analyst is checked. It should be by default, but occasionally we find that somehow somebody has managed to uncheck it. So under Spatial Analyst Tools, click on Map Algebra to expand that toolbox, and click on Raster Calculator to open the Raster Calculator. The Raster Calculator essentially adds the value of each of these pixels to one another in the layer. The formula that I have given you is essentially adding the fault proximity risks times 10 times 5, the slip rate times 4, the other slip rate times 2, the liquefaction rate, and then to the basin depth rate, and then multiplying it by the land sea layer, which you don't see, which is essentially just a 1-0 map that makes all of the sea values 0. And you can maybe click OK, but I'm going to, in the output raster, note that I want this layer to be called SoCal Damage Risk Map. And I'm going to cross my fingers and click OK. The raster calculator should be working in the background. Sometimes it's hard to tell if anything is going on. Give it a moment. And down here in the corner, you see the raster calculator has worked and a map has been produced. I'm going to zoom out just a little bit here so you can see it. The raster calculator by default has a tendency to present the map in black and white, and I don't really like that. So over here in the table of contents, click once on the color ramp and perhaps change it to something like this map, this layer here. Different colors are fine, and generally invert. See how you like it, so that blue is a very low risk and that these dark brown or reddish areas are high risk. In order to finish this lab, you have to click, hold down, and drag this layer below at least the SoCal Quakes layer. That way you can see how there is a correlation between the faults and these risk. And the last bit that you're going to be asked to do is to zoom in on one of these, or on a series of the malls. I'm zooming in quite closely here on the South Bay Galleria, and note then that you can click on the Identify tool and click very close to but not on the South Bay Galleria point layer, and when you do, it will bring up the risk value, which is the pixel value in your SoCal damage risk map layer. This is what you will use, this value, to answer a handful of questions, and that finishes the lab. I'm going to zoom back out here so you can see that. Your questions will be mostly about the malls in the greater San Fernando Valley region. I hope you have found this enjoyable and interesting. This kind of modeling of risk is used in a wide variety of applications, not just natural disasters, but also in business and health, for governmental applications. And we have a number of geography graduates that have gotten jobs doing exactly this sort of thing and making a good living, while at the same time getting to go outside and collect data. I hope you've enjoyed it. That concludes this video tutorial on damage and risk assessment in Southern California.